ॐ साईश्वराय विद्महे सत्यदेवाय धीमहि तन्नः सर्व प्रचोदयात्।
Thank you very much for your time and gracious presence for this morning satsang. Well, most of us often think, what is the meaning of life? What is the meaning of life is a question that everyone puts to one's own self. What's the meaning? Why should I live? What is the purpose? Why? What is the aim? These are the questions that we put to ourselves. But actually speaking, these are all the questions which are to be raised by a businessman, not by a spiritual man. These are the questions that come to the mind of man of business management, not of spiritual science. Simple example, we have cool breeze in the evening. What is the meaning of cool breeze? What is the purpose of cool breeze? Why cool breeze? Silly. Cool breeze has no meaning. It is just like that. You find the flower so beautiful and fragrant. Why? What is the meaning? Our questioning mind, our business mind, always puts this question. Why? What is its meaning? There is no meaning. When once you get into this area of meaning, the whole thing becomes limited. If you ask a businessman, what is the meaning of life? To mint money. Good. So, money is limited. It's not the only thing. And if you ask a scientist, what is the meaning? I should invent an atom bomb by which all can be killed within second. Oh, very good. That's meaning. What is the meaning of politician? At least prime minister of this country. Politics limited. Science limited. Social sciences limited. What I want to draw your attention is, to put a question, meaning of life is meaningless. Because life is meaningless. It has no meaning. Life has to be lived, not for a meaning. Just as the beauty. What is the meaning of beauty? The meaning of beauty is being beautiful. What is the meaning of truth? By being truthful. That's all. Be. You be, be. That's what it is. But we are very much bothered to know the meaning of life, the purpose of life. That's what we put to ourselves. But some people may say, this is what I think, the meaning of life. The way how you think is your imagination. The meaning that you give to the life is your own imagination. I say this meaning, okay, in your meaning, I have different meaning. The way how you take it is not uniform, cannot be generalized. Therefore, the meaning of life is left to one's own imagination. The second point is, when once you give the meaning, it becomes a limitation. You will narrow it. You cannot say meaning of ocean, meaning of space. No. I can say what my limited area, the purpose, the aim, the vastness, the infinity, the limitless has no meaning. That which has a meaning is limited. That which has no meaning is vast, abundant, limitless. So human life, which is essentially divine, life is divine. The body may be changing, body may be human, body may have a name, body has a beginning and an end, but life has no beginning, has no end. Life is eternal. Life is continuous. Life is immortal. Life has no beginning, has no end. In other words, life is existence. Life is limitless. How can we give meaning? So, giving meaning to life, meaning you are getting it limited. Attributing some meaning to life is one's own imagination. And also pity and silly to define the meaning of life. Why is this? You say this is the meaning of life from my viewpoint, right? What is the meaning of life? This is what I think. So the meaning of life is given from the point of I, from the point of ego. So meaning of life is given by the ego, by the center of I-ness. In other words, meaning of life is meaningless. The meaning that we give is just our own imagination. And the meaning will make it limited, limitation, narrow, restricted. Life in general is limitless without any boundaries. And the so-called meaning is only from the point of I or ego. The next point is this. When once I say I am the truth, what is truth? Can I say this is not truth? Can I say this is not truth? In other words, as Baba always says it, Trikala Bhajyam, which is indivisible, that which is indivisible is truth. You cannot say this is truth and that is not. I cannot say this I and that I am not. The I in me is same as I in you. There are no two I's. It may be I's, I see. It cannot be I's. The I in me is same as I in you. In other words, I is indivisible. There is nothing like my I and your I. And this I, and that is not I, nothing like that. This I-ness is uniform, which is consciousness, that ever brilliant, that ever radiant. How can I limit it? How can I define it? Therefore, to go beyond all limits is the duty of a spiritual seeker. A spiritual aspirant should be after limitless. Limitless. So why? Because I am limited with this body, name and form. From this name and form, mind and intellect, body, operating, I am limited. My journey towards limitless. I think I am born that I would end my life. This is mortality. The journey should be from mortality to immortality. To divide you and me, to say that this I am, that I am not, is wrong. Division is not true. In other words, we divide as persons. We divide regionally, nationally, caste, cadre, gender, every possible way we want to get divided. We find ourselves comfortable in division. Because division gives you an identity. Division makes you egoistic. Division makes you feel that you are separate. But that is not truth. This separateness, this identification is not truth. Because truth is indivisible. Asatoma sadgamaya. Asat and sat. To consider truth as divided is asat. To know the truth is one is sat. Asatoma sadgamaya. From division to oneness. From duality to non-duality. We just join in chorus, Asatoma Sadgamaya. What is the meaning? If our prayer of Asatoma Sadgamaya is real from the heart, we cannot have any differences. We cannot have any kind of division. Because truth is one. Truth is one. Ekam Sat, truth is one. So, to consider truth being different is asat. And to know the truth is one is sat. Asatoma sadgamaya. We have got another prayer. Mrityorma amrutangamaya. Mrity is death. Amruta is immortality. Death is false. There is no death. Why? It is the body that dies, but not you. The real I does not die. It is only the body. Therefore, this mriti or death is limited, narrow, false, body, identification, mind, ego. That's death, that's all. So, to consider that I am the body is death. To identify with my mind is death. No, but I am beyond the body, beyond the mind, beyond the intellect. I am that awareness, I am that consciousness. This is amrutatva or immortality. So, from mriti to amrita, meaning from mortality to immortality is our prayer. By the grace of God, but that illuminated mind, that over mind, that higher mind, that awakened mind, that enlightened mind, that meditative mind. Meditative mind, the mind turned inwards, will dispel the darkness. Something like light removes darkness. What is darkness here? When there is light, we think it is dark. If I say it's dark, dark, what would you tell me? Mr. Anil Kumar, please consult eye specialist. There's a lot of light. Why do you say it is dark? Something wrong with you. So similarly, to think there is death is darkness, ignorance. Death is ignorance. Birth is ignorance. Death and birth are imagination, are illusory. illusory, deluding, but you are eternal. So tamas, darkness, meaning the darkness of mortality, the darkness of untruth. This should go jyotirgamaya, the jyoti light, awakening, awareness, consciousness. Jyoti, the light of awareness, the light of alertness, the light of wakefulness, the light of awareness. So with the jyoti, you can get out of this tamas, that is our regular prayer. Therefore, my friends, very important thing is that you have got to realize that there are many things that cannot be put within the frame of our vocabulary. I cannot say. When Buddha was asked, is there God? People asked Buddha, where is God? Is there God? He remained silent. No answer. No answer. Why? People thought that Buddha is atheist. People thought that Buddha is against God because he was silent. Why did he remain silent? When you use the word God, the rest are ungodly or non-godly or what? When you use one word God, tell me which is not God. Tell me who is not God. The word is useless to explain godliness. So you cannot say God. No, you cannot say that. Because tell me what is not God. Sarvam Vishnumayam Jagat. The entire universe is fully divine. Sarvam Vishnumayam Jagat. Vasudeva Sarvamiti. Anuraniyan Mahato Mahiyan. From microcosm to macrocosm, everything is divine. How do you say God? When there are two, this is God, that is man. That is God, this is man. That is God, this is man, this is nature. So name or word arises out of duality. David is separate from Nelson. Nelson is separate from Paul. We have got different names. Name, good. Professions separate, good. But God is not a word. Because there is no second thing. When there is a second thing, you can name it. When there is no second, what do you say? The one without the second. Advitiyam. Ekam eva advitiyam brahma. Ekam, only one. Advitiya, the one without the second. Brahman, God. So God is one without the second. Ekam eva advitiyam brahma. How do we give the name? So the word is also not applicable. That's why many saints observed silence. Not that they cannot speak. Not that they do not know words. Not that they run short of vocabulary. They remained silent. Why? Because word will not reach. Word cannot limit. Word is non-expressive. Word is useless instrument. Therefore, many people observed silence. These scientists, they dropped speaking, they dropped all words. That's why Upanishad says, yato vacho nivartante. Yato vacho nivartante. The word wanted to reach God. Words, they failed and returned successfully. It is a successful failure. Why? Words want to describe. No, they return. So the reality is wordless. Divinity is wordless. Divinity is meaningless. What all we say, it's only our own imagination. That's what we have to understand it. And some people go one step further. You know, I forget myself when I'm in meditation. If you have one bottle of scotch whiskey, you can forget yourself. Or when you take one sleeping tablet, you can forget yourself. It is not forgetfulness that is important. No. Self-forgetfulness is not meditation. Self-remembrance is meditation. Self-remembrance. I remember the self, not I-ness, not ego. Self, the cosmic self, the super self, the consciousness. Remember, it has to be recalled. It has to be remembered. One has to be in constant touch with it. So self-remembrance is meditation and not self-forgetfulness. Then what happens? When I think of myself, the self, what happens? I'll certainly understand that I am not the body, I am not the mind, I am not the intellect. Then what are you? You have immersed yourself. You have drowned yourself. You have been deeply sunk, basked in yourself. I have gone to myself, meaning what? Now I am within myself, means what? I have gone beyond the body. I have gone beyond the mind. I have gone beyond the intellect. I have started reflecting on the self, the consciousness. That's what is meant by go within. Somebody asked me, Anil Kumar, what is the meaning of going within? I said, no bus takes you there. There are no special flights to within. There are flights to without. There are no flights to within. There are trains to without. There are no trains to within. Because words cannot reach, thought cannot reach. Yato vacho nivartante aprapya manasasaha. Mind also cannot reach. Words cannot explain. When mind cannot comprehend, when words fail to express the profundity and the depth of the divinity, and return in total failure, the word and the mind returning utter flop in total helplessness, what remains there? Only self. Only the self. Meaning, if I have understood that words fail to express, I should be wordless. If I understood that mind cannot reach, I should be thoughtless. So wordless, thoughtless state is the experience of the self. That is meditation. That is enlightenment. That is what awareness is. That's what samadhi is. Samadhi, meaning that awareness of being within one's own self, that what it is. My friends, Baba said in his own style these ideas. We are after Baba because the most difficult things are put in an interesting way, but we take things for granted. We go superficially. Some boy was telling me, he's a PhD boy, sir, let us have a seminar. Oh yes, why not? Around what? proper study of mankind is man. That's what Baba says. Shall we have seminar? Then I said, do you know what study is? First, know what study is. Second, know what proper study is. Because study can be improper also. Mankind, know what is man and what is kindness. Then start a seminar. First you come to conclusion what it is. Therefore, my friends, Swami says so many things and we take it casually. But every statement has got to be reflected. We have to ponder over every sentence, every thought. Then we will go deep into that. Let's go into the depth, not superficial. I have been telling my friends for the last 4 Thursdays, during my Thursday satsang. As you know that we started Thursday satsangs also. One of the Thursday satsangs, somehow I felt saying this, how long shall we spend time in storytelling? How long should I spend time by narrating experiences? How long should I spend in bloating in ego? I have been in Puttaparthi for 25 years. So what? The electric poles have been there for now 50 years. What? So what? No, I mean in Puttaparthi doing that and this. What for? What for? How long? In ignorance, in innocence, we have been claiming our seniority. We have been claiming our positions here, which are not true. This is asat, untruth. Flies and mosquitoes fall on me also. So merely staying here is not that. That awareness, that consciousness is absolutely necessary. That what is the proof now? Bhagavan explains clearly. That which comes to our experience is the true sign of the reality. To your experience. But we don't want to experience the reality because we have so many desires. We have so many needs. What should come to my experience now? I should be free from my joint pains. What should come to my experience now? I should get a promotion in my job. That I should be free from ailment. These are the experiences we want. What ultimate experience you want? I want to be deathless. Let there not be death at all. Who said there is death? If there is death, you can pray to be deathless. There is no death. Then why should you pray for deathlessness? Nainam chandanti sastrani, nainam dahati pavaka, nainam kledayam chapo, nasoshayati marutaha. When the self is indestructible, imperishable, blemishless, eternal, the one without the second, who is going to die? What is the meaning in praying, oh God, save me from death? It is something like this, oh God, give me some oxygen to breathe. There is oxygen around, you breathe, you close your nose. There is oxygen everywhere. Similarly, when the reality is at the doorstep, you are in the reality. You are the reality. When this is forgotten, when this has not come to our experience, we cannot understand Bhagavan Sri Satya Sai Baba. Secondly, we also understand. Sometimes there's one gentleman who told me, you know, I can say what Baba feels on this. You thought that I am a great fool. All right. Why not let him come out with his foolishness? Further he said, I know what Swami would say. I know how Swami would comment. I know what he said. I told him, after listening to him, if you know what he is going to say, he is not God. Better I quit from this place. You cannot know God. If you say, I know what Baba says, what do you know? You do not know that you do not know. Because God cannot be known. Known, unknown, relate to the mind. I know, so known. I do not know, unknown. Known, unknown are at the level of the mind. But God is beyond the known and unknown, above, because he is unknowable. Aprameya, nirupamana, anirvachana, indefinable, no comparison, cannot know that. So if you say, I know Baba, meaning, you do not know that you do not know. Therefore, Bhagavan clearly said, you cannot know me. Swami, oh I see, I cannot know you. Then why should I be here? When I cannot know you, I own my own house at my native place. I can go back, have little more ventilation and breeze, free from constant pushing by this avadan. Why can't I go back? Why? And Baba said, you cannot know me, but you can experience me. So we have to experience him. Not knowing him. This I can put it this way. Knowing about God. Knowing about God is knowledge. Knowing about God is scripture. Knowing about God is a pursuit, an inquiry. Knowing about God is different from being God. Knowing about God is different from being God. That's why Baba tells in every talk, you are God, you are God, you are God. Then we'll say, sorry, if I'm God, all right, I don't get anything extra. I don't get any extra increment. I don't get any extra furniture if I am God. And I am not going to be offered a big bungalow if I am God. Why? You say that I am God. All right, I'll forget it. When he says you are God, all are divine. Embodiments of divine Atma. That's how he addresses his devotees. He will never say ladies and gentlemen. He will never say brothers and sisters. He addresses us as embodiments of the divine. Embodiments of love. It only means when that love comes to experience, when that divinity comes to experience, that is knowing Baba. If I know what ice cream is, it's not enough. I should eat it, right? You cannot say, explain about ice cream and say, thank you, meet tomorrow. Would you say that? I should eat it. So, divinity is not knowledge. Baba is not knowledge. Baba is an experience, as he has said. At the age of 14, when he walked out of the house, throwing away the books aside, at the age of 14, what did he say? No electronic equipment can know me. No mind can understand me. You cannot estimate me. You cannot know me. I am Sai Baba, said Bhagavan Sri Sat Sai Baba. October 20th, 1940. While he was very young, he declared so.
It only means, Swami, you have said at the age of 14, but at the age of 80, I am not understanding it. What did you say? You cannot understand me. What I am doing? I am trying to understand and say that I understand. Higher foolishness. When he says, you cannot estimate me, well, I am sure I can estimate you. So, he is light, I am the darkness. He is the light and the delight, while I am eternally dark. That's why I have to take life after life, life after life, life after life, birth, death, cycle. How many times should I appear for examination? One March examination, supplementary examination. March examination, supplementary examination. I asked my teacher, sir, how many times should I appear for examination? The teacher tells me, until you pass. Until you pass, you have to repeat. Ghazni Muhammad invaded India 12 times. So I call those fellows who failed successively, immediate cousins of Ghazni Muhammad. Therefore, this kind of birth and death, the life cycle happens again and again. Punarapi jananam, punarapi maranam, punarapi janani jethare seyanam, punarapi janani jethare seyanam. The life goes on getting repeated, on and on and on, until I experience I am divine. Until I know that I am divine. Until I realize I am God. That's what Baba's message is. Swami in fact said, and a devotee said, Bhagwan, you have given me so much of happiness. And now you are going back to Puttaparthi. You are here in Bangalore for 2 months. Morning and evening we enjoyed your divine presence. We are in blissful moments. Bangalore, Swami spends summer in Bangalore. We enjoyed you, Swami. Now you are going to Puttaparthi. Is it proper on your part to do that? Is it proper on your part to do that? Are you correct in quitting this place and going like that simply? This is the answer of Baba. Why do you worry? Do you think that I am leaving you? Do you think that you are here and I am going there? Let us know this what he said. I am not going anywhere. I have not come from anywhere. If I come from somewhere, I can go back. I have not come from somewhere. I don't go anywhere because I am everywhere. I am everywhere. There is no question of somewhere and somewhere else. Swami, I don't understand. Then he says, I am in your heart. I am in your heart. Your heart is my residence. So you don't need to bother and worry about it. Further he said, as individuals, we have got our own friends, the company of friends. Who are they? The like-minded friends. Who are they that support us? Who are they that agree with us? Baba said they are not true friends. Those that agree with you, those that praise you, those who are with you are not friends. There are no friends at all in this world. Baba said clearly to boys, Aray, you have number of friends, Ra. When there's money in the pocket, father in position, you'll have number of friends. The moment father retires, the day the pocket is empty, you will know that you don't have friends. You will know that you don't have friends really. Therefore, Baba says, if ever you want to have a friend, develop friendship with God. Develop friendship with God. Because friendship in Sanskrit is called Maitri. Maitri, friendship, Sanskrit. Swami Saraswati, he splits this. Mai. Three periods of time, past, present and future. The one who remains with you in all the three periods of time, that relationship is true friendship, Maitri. Who will remain with you in all the three periods of time? Your friends in the college, they meet you during college times. Your roommate is your friend until you come out of the room. But tell me the friend who is always with you, then, now and forever. Only God. So Swami says, don't run after other friends. If at all you are to have, I am your best friend. Bhakta Sakha Bhagavan, Bhakta Sakha Bhagavan, Hey, Bhakta Sakha Bhagavan, Bhakta Sakha Bhagavan. God is the friend of a devotee. That's what Bhagavan says. If you have that feeling, I'll take care of you like your eyelid. As the eyelid protects your eye, I am always with you. That's what Bhagavan says. But how do you feel it? How do you know? How do you know? Swami says, out of devotion only you can experience. It is only devotion that helps you develop friendship. You know that. Rasavilola Nandalala Radha Madhava Nandalala Rasavilola Nandalala Nandakishora Nandalala Navanita Chora Nandalala Rasavilola Nandalala. That kinds of friendship, Rasavilola, that Rasalila is friendship with God that is demonstrated in the life of Bhagavan Krishna. That's what he says. Swami, would you give me some example to know that? To know that you are in me? To know that you are with me? To know that you are like my eyelid? Would you tell me one example? Swami gives this beautiful example. Paddy grain will have outer covering called husk, H-U-S-K. Remove the husk, you'll find white grain, rice grain. Every rice grain is covered by outer husk. When you remove the husk, you'll see the rice grain. Similarly, I am always with you, understand that. You are the husk, the body the husk, the mind the husk. I am the grain, the divinity within you. The divinity within you is the grain. Both are inseparable. Both are together. Understand it. And Swami said this. What a fine thing it is. Just as our people offer their Sarvadharma prayers, Ramakrishna Prabhutu, Hey Ram, Hey Ram. Hey Ram, Ramakrishna Prabhutu, Ram. You are Allah, Ishwar. You are Buddha, yes, Bhagavan. You are all in one. This is the statement of Bhagavan. Understand that Sai name, Sai Ram, has all the potential of Rama, Krishna, Shiva, Maruti, Dattatreya, the power of all deities, the power of all gods are contained in this Sai Ram. Instead of swallowing 10 tablets, A vitamin, B vitamin, C vitamin, D vitamin, E vitamin, some more vitamins, swallow one multivitamin tablet. That is such a Sai Ram. Oh, one tablet enough. Kadam, that's all. So, all the power is latent in me, declares Baba. Swami, in this spiritual journey, in this spiritual thirst, in this spiritual hunger, in this spiritual inquiry, in this spiritual sojourn, would you tell me the different steps? Because as we go to Bangalore, I can tell you different stations in between. You'll see some Chikmalapur, you'll see some Bagepalli and all that. Finally, you go to Bangalore. Similarly, to know that, to know me, you are not knowing anybody. To know me, to know the self in me, to know that the self is you, that you are within me. What are these stages? Bhagavan says, first thing is, understand that you belong to God, that you belong to kingdom of God. Yes, I belong to His kingdom. Let thy kingdom come. That is the Christian's prayer. Let thy kingdom come. Because we belong to human kingdom. We belong to political governments. We belong to dictators. We belong to offices. We belong to different services and families. No, no, no. You belong to kingdom of heaven. Kingdom of heaven. Lord Bhagavan Jesus, King of kings, Lord of lords. So be firmly established in the feeling that you belong to kingdom of heaven, that you belong to the Lord. Oh, when you belong to the kingdom of God, there will be no shortage. There is no dearth. When you are in the hotel, you don't need to go for food anywhere. You are in the hotel. Yes? When you are the jeweler, you don't need to buy gold somewhere else. When you belong to the kingdom of God, there is no shortage. There is no dearth of anything, anything. This Swami calls it as Salokya. Salokya. S-A-L-O-K-Y-A. Salokya, the feeling of belonging to kingdom of God. Yes. If you belong to the kingdom, good, that gives confidence. Then what happens? We want to do something. We want to do something in the kingdom. We are not idle. We are idle, unemployed, and non-productive. We are just a baggage, unwanted stuff. We should do something to please Him. Let the King of Kings be happy with whatever I do now because I belong to His kingdom. I cannot oppose Him. I cannot criticize Him. I cannot negate Him. Let me do something to make my King happy because this is His kingdom. Therefore, to please the king, you should do certain things that would please him, that would appeal him, so that he would be merciful to you. So, actions that would please your king in the kingdom of God will take you near him. Will take you near him. That is called samipya. Samipya, salokya, the family belong to the kingdom of God. Samipya, we do certain actions that would be pleasing to the king, such that we'll be near and dear to him. Next, what happens? You know, here we may not recognize, when we go back to our native places, at times we go for a break or for some occasion. When we go back, our friends and relatives notice a change in us. Am I not right? They say, what happened to you? Why are you not interested in our talk? Why are you not interested in our politics? Why are you not interested in our property matters? Why are you not interested in our daughters, daughters-in-law, sons, sons-in-law? Why? What happened to you? You seem to be indifferent. There is a change within. Noticed by outsider, not anybody among us. Suddenly, a friend comes and sees you after 2 years. He will say, oh, you are thinner, huh? You lost your weight. He's surprised, but nobody will tell me here. One friend tells, because he will notice the change. As we meet every day, we don't notice the change. The change is noticed by an outsider. That you have been transformed. He finds some happiness on your face. If there is no happiness on our face, we are not, certainly not from Puttaparthi. Certainly not. You may show your ration card, you may show election card, or you may say Aadhaar card, you are just a postcard. There should be happiness on the face because you are from kingdom of God. Bhagwan Sri Sat Sai Baba. There should be bliss on your face because you are serving him in Prashantanalayam. You do some seva or other, therefore there should be bliss on your face. There should be happiness on your face. There should be some peace around you. You should be in peace and make others peaceful. So, when the peace is missing and your face is something like a frying pan that everybody would like to avoid you, it is useless to be here. Life is a dustbin. Life is a garbage. Having been here in Puttaparthi, if we don't have that bliss, if we don't have that happiness, don't have that smile, if you have no glimpses of peace, stay here is useless. Bringing a bad name to the place, and Swami also. This stuff is there, oh, better I don't go. It's not that. He is so happy, why? Because he is there. You know, some of our friends making calls to everybody. Everyone says, you are luckiest person on earth. You are really grand. You are very lucky because you are staying in God's place, in the kingdom of God. Everybody congratulates you. Though we may not say no, face does not convey that. Face does not convey any approval of it. When the other man says, you are luckiest man buying in Puttaparthi, you go, ah, I say, luckiest man won't say like that. That fellow will show better face when you give him 10 rupees, not this. What am I to do? Therefore, enjoying the bliss of Bhagavan, enjoying the happiness of Bhagavan, imbibing peace of Bhagavan, the laughter, the ecstasy, the music, the bliss, all that Baba symbolizes. If you are a replica, then you belong to the kingdom of God. That is called sarupya. Sarupya. Here is a block of gold. When I cut it into two, equally gold. This part is not clay and this is not gold, no. Come on, break it. The brick, golden brick, into any number of bits. Every little piece is golden, is gold only. Similarly, having been in the place of God, Salokya, working for Him, Samipya, we should be a carbon copy, a replica of Bhagavan. That's what is meant by Sarupya. That's why some of our friends, it must be experienced to everybody. Many people will come in, what are you talking? What are you talking? I feel just Baba is talking to us. We feel the Swami has got a piece of advice to us. We understand that Swami has sent you to talk to us. We understand Swami has got some news, some message to convey to us. Therefore you are speaking like that. Meaning they see Swami in you. That is what we call sarupya. Same replica. And finally what happens? Finally what happens? I do not exist. I am not. I am not. Then who is there? He alone is there. I am not He. River is not there when once it merges into ocean. Spark of the fire is not there when he returns to the source of fire. So this entity, this separateness, this individuality, this identification do not exist anymore. I-ness is completely gone, only He. Total merger. This is what is called Sayujya. Therefore Bhagavan says, these are the steps. Know that you are in the kingdom of God. Try to serve Him. Carry His message in your life. In the company of anyone you mix with. And finally, you experience me. That's what Sayujya is Bhagavan, what Bhagavan says. My friends, what a lovely change. What a wonderful phenomenon we are going through today. I'm sure that most of you have come to know by this time, more miracles are happening today than ever before. More miracles. People are feeling Him. People are experiencing Him. Till now, people are bloating in ego, pride. You know, Swami spoke to me. So what? So what? Swami speaks to you, that doesn't mean you should tell me. Not necessary. You don't tell me every conversation that happens in your home, do you? So all gifts, rings, watches, lockets, chains, interviews, darshans, padanamaskar, they have become matters of publicity, propaganda, vanity, ego. Now that's all gone. Hari Om Tat Sat. And if anyone speaks, Swami spoke to me. No. No. Now better we say, Swami speaks to me. Not the question of spoke to me. Spoke, speak, spoke, spoken. Spoke is past tense. He speaks to me. Present tense. Does he speak to me? Yes, why not? He speaks to me from within, inner voice. the inner voice. When you seek to Him, when you seek Him, you get the answer, inner voice. Do this, don't do that. Go to Him, don't go there. This is good, this is not. But we don't care the inner voice, because we are busy with outer noise. Very busy with outer noise. Unless the outer noise is silenced, inner voice cannot be heard. So, hereafter, we should say, Swami speaks to Him, speaks to me. How? Inner voice. What does He say? It's not your problem. It's not your problem. But till now, we go on bothering everybody, stop traffic also, to show the ring and the chain that we got it. Because of Himalayan ego, oceanic pride, everything should be a piece of propaganda or publicity. We cannot do that hereafter. Swami is ever present. He spoke to me and He continues to speak to me. Swami speaks. You cannot say will speak or spoke English wrong. Sai speaks. That's one. Two, Swami gave me this ring, gave me this watch. Till now. Hereafter, He gave me the ring to know that I have to come out of the ring of cycle of birth and death. The ring, I am in the ring now. He wants me to come out of the ring. Its application, its meaning, I should recognize and think deep enough behind these gifts of grace. Necessary or unnecessary? I go on showing this watch, so what? The watch that He has given me may stop sometime. I know some of the boys going to the watch repairer to get repaired. And that fellow tells me, Swami, yes, don't say that, you're going to get it repaired. This watch, what He has given outer, stop it. Watch your words, actions, thoughts, character, heart, that is the now. That is the purpose of the watch. To come out of the ring of life is the purpose of the ring. In one gala meeting, one elderly man was asked to speak. It's my bad luck to have been present there. He had taken out the buttons, took out the chain. This is the chain Swami has given. Telling everybody. I said, what a fool, must be from lunatic asylum. Yes, why should you demonstrate like that? It is only personal thing. How can you make personal general? I felt so bad, very unlucky to have been present at the meeting. Later I told him, sir, don't do that. Don't do that. If you show this, the chain, this is so what? You are still chained. Chained in the bondage of sensual pleasure, in the bondage of worldly attachment, you are chained. Come out of the chain, break the chain. That is the message. Of course, he stopped talking to me from then onwards. That is the result. And I said, sir, you are lucky, sir. You are a blessed soul. You got the chain. I did not get it. You would have offered me some cup of coffee also. I am deprived of that. So, we should come out of the chain of birth and death, the chain of sensual pleasure, the ring of life, to be watchful of the watch, should be the interpretation of the life from now on. I had Pada Namaskar. No longer I touched Mahasamadhi with my forehead. With my forehead, I touched Mahasamadhi. While Pada Namaskar was a matter of publicity, because some do Pada Namaskar while watching the neighbors, whether others have known or not. What is Pada Namaskar when you don't see me? doing it. So that everybody should say, So that Padanamaskar may be outer thing till now, a matter for recognition, for others to see. Today, you bow down, touch your forehead, that Mahasamadhi. Feel the vibration, feel the waves, feel the electromagnetic waves, feel the spiritual vibration. That's what should happen now onwards. Until now, we have been offering a flower to Swami. He takes a flower as a token of love, especially on birthdays and all that. Hereafter, the flower of my thought, the fruit of my action. O Lord, I surrender to you. O Lord, I offer the flowers of my thoughts. I offer the fruit of my action to thy lotus feet, my Lord, should be the spirit hereafter. From name to namelessness, from attributes to attributelessness, from form to formlessness, from untruth to truth, from darkness to light, from death to immortality, be our spiritual journey. May Bhagavan be with you forever and ever. Sai Ram. Asato ma sadgam tamaso ma jyotirgamaya mrutyorma amrutangamaya om samasta loka sukhino bhavantu samastalokah sukhino bhavantu samastalokah sukhino bhavantu om shanti shanti shanti. Jai bolo Bhagwan Sri Satsai Baba Ji ki.
Jai
bolo Bhagwan Sri Satsai Baba Ji ki.
Jai
bolo Bhagwan Sri Satsai Baba Ji ki. God bless you.
Om Saishwaraya Vidmahe Satya Devaya Dhimahi Tannas Sarva Prachodayat. Om Saishwaraya Vidmahe Satya Devaya Dhimahi Tannas Sarva Prachodayat. Om Saishwaraya Vidmahe Satya Devaya Dhimahi Tannas Sarva Prachodayat. Om Saishwaraya Vidmahe Satya Devaya Dhimahi Tannas Sarva Prachodayat. Om Saishwaraya Vidmahe Satya Devaya Dhimahi Tannas Sarva Prachodayat. Om Saishwaraya Vidmahe Satya Devaya Dhimahi Tannas Sarva Prachodayat. Om Saishwaraya Vidmahe Satya Devaya Dhimahi Tannas Sarva Prachodayat. ॐ साईश्वराय विद्महे सत्यदेवाय धीमहि